Hello everyone, welcome to week 10 of special crime investigation with simulation to interview and interrogation. Today we are going to continue on corporate crimes. We are going to discuss the types of corporate and economic corporate crimes. Our first topic would be who commit corporate crimes. The question that who commit corporate crime is vital in the context of whom the criminal justice system is required to fix the responsibility. Though the question of whether corporations are criminally liable or not is no more open for discussion in all the jurisdictions throughout the world, yet the question remains how to justify the ends of criminal justice system by fixing liability on the corporation as a whole or the individuals in the vicarious capacity. The liability of the corporation. According to the theories propounded by the jurists and adopted in practice by the common law countries, the rule is that a corporation will be criminally liable for the illegal acts of its employees if the employees are acting within the scope of their authority and their conduct benefits the corporation. The corporation may be held criminally responsible for the illegal conduct of its employees if, number one, the illegal act was committed while the employee was acting within the scope of employment. Second, the employee's conduct was undertaken at least in part for the benefit of the corporation. Next, liability of individuals. Individuals within the corporation are also liable for their criminal acts. In such cases, the question is whether there is a vicarious liability of the directors of the company for the wrongs for which the company is liable as a distinct entity. The Supreme Court of India has clarified that as a cardinal principle of criminal jurisprudence, there is no vicarious liability unless the statute specifically provides so. An individual was perpetrated the commission of an offense on behalf of the company can be prosecuted along with the company when there is sufficient evidence of his active role coupled with criminal intent. One can also be prosecuted when there is some statutory provision which attracts the doctrine of vicarious liability by specifically incorporating such provisions. It has been further laid down by the court that when a company is an offender, vicarious liability of the directors cannot be automatically imputed in the absence of statutory provisions to this effect, like Section 70 of the Money Laundering Act 2002, which reads under 1. Offenses by companies for a person committing a contravention or violation of any of the provisions of the Money Laundering Act or of any rule, direction or order made thereunder is a company. Every person who at the time the contravention or violation was committed was in charge of and was responsible to the company for the conduct of the business of the company, as well as the company shall be deemed to be guilty of the contravention and shall be liable to be proceeded against and punished accordingly. Provided that nothing contained in this subsection shall render any such person liable to punishment if he proves that the contravention took place without his knowledge or that he exercised all due diligence to prevent such contravention. Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection for a contravention of any of the provisions of this act or of any rule, direction or order made thereunder has been committed by a company and it is proved that the contravention has taken place with the consent or connivance of or is attributable to any neglect on the part of any director, manager, secretary, or other officers of any company, such director, manager, secretary, or other officers shall also be deemed to be guilty of the contravention and shall be liable to be proceeded against and punished accordingly. We have here the situational circumstances of corporate liability, conduct of employee. The courts have formulated their little code books for fixing the criminal liability of the firms for the misconduct of an employee or the employer or the company itself, as there is no comprehensive statute to deal with it. The courts in the past decades have observed that for a corporation to be criminally liable, the employee's conduct must be for the benefit of the corporation. This requirement, however, is satisfied regardless of whether the corporation receives an actual benefit. The corporation is considered to have received a benefit if the employee engaged in criminal conduct with the intent to benefit the corporation. Moreover, intent to benefit the corporation does not have to be the sole or even primary motivation for the employee's conduct. Two, personal gains. The benefit requirement is satisfied even when the employee's conduct is performed for his or her gain. And the corporation somehow benefits from the conducts as well. For example, one such case involved a convicted corporation arguing that it should not have been held accountable because the criminal activity was intended solely to benefit the employee in his quest to climb the corporate ladder. The argument cannot be, as the corporation could still receive a benefit in light of the fact the employee's promotions were conditioned on the success of the corporation. Third, hierarchy of employment. As to the limitation that employees must be acting within the scope of their actual or apparent authority, the position of authority means that he should be in a position of decision making. The American jurisprudence found that even a single low level employee's criminal conduct can be sufficient to trigger criminal liability on the part of the corporation. Moreover, it may not even be necessary to find the identity of the same criminal employee to find the employer guilty. For criminal conduct, an employee will be criminally liable for actively and directly engaging in criminal conduct. A corporate employee cannot hide from criminal liability merely by claiming the conduct occurred during the scope of employment. Criminal conspiracy. A conspiracy occurs whenever two or more people agree to commit an offense, and one of those persons takes an affirmative act in furtherance of the goals of the conspiracy. in prosecuting a scheme that involves separate rules for co-conspirators, there is no need to prove that each participant directly interacted with each of the other conspirators. It is also not required to prove that each co-conspirator knew all the details of the agreement and participated in all of its operations, or joined the agreement at the same time, or became aware of all the activities of the other participants in the agreement. Then we have the doctrine of responsible corporate officer. The responsible corporate officer doctrine originally emerged from the U.S. Supreme Court case of United States versus Daughter Weeks. Approximately 32 years later, the Supreme Court reaffirmed the existence of the responsible corporate officer doctrine in the landmark case of the United States versus Parr. In both cases, the court held that a corporate officer could be liable for the criminal acts of the corporation, despite the officer never having been aware of the criminal conduct at issue. Despite the officer having no guilty mind, no? So, take note of that. Ulitin ko yung parting yun. A corporate officer could be liable for the criminal acts of the corporation despite na hindi siya aware sa mga criminal conduct, despite na wala siyang guilty mind. In part, the court noted that the corporate officer cannot be convicted under this doctrine merely because of his or her position within the company. A relationship must exist between the officer's corporate function and the conduct in question to such a degree that the officer is not only responsible for solving the problem, but also under an affirmative duty to implement measures that will ensure the violations will not occur. In this regard, the Indian position has been discussed above, where the apex court has ruled that the officer can only be roped in when there is sufficient incriminatory evidence against him or it is provided so in the statute. The statutory provisions as contained in different Indian enactments similarly provide a defense to the concerned person by proving that contravention took place without his knowledge or that he exercised all due diligence to prevent such contravention. Next, you have defenses against liability. Corporations may escape liability by establishing a defense, unless the offense is one for which absolute liability has been imposed. The corporation may be able to establish a defense if it can prove by a preponderance of evidence that the high managerial agent having supervisory responsibility for the subject matter of the offense employed due diligence to prevent its commission. In Tesco supermarkets, LT versus Natras 81, it was clarified that defense of due diligence could not be established merely by showing that a good system had been devised and person thought to be competent put in charge of it. It would still be necessary to show due diligence on the part of the accused in seeing that the system was operated and the person put in charge of it is doing what he was supposed to do. Let us move on to the types of corporate crimes. First, industrial disasters. With the growing importance of the companies in our lives, there has been an increase in the risk and destruction caused by these companies too. This destruction can take place at any stage, production, processing, storage, disposal, and others. A random slip of operations in handling the chemicals or the radioactive material or any other form of energy can lead to great damage to the surrounding atmosphere. More than 3,000 people died and over people and other people were exposed to metal isocyanate gas. On the night of December 2, 1984, when water entered into a wrong compartment due to a missing pipe, which resulted in an injury that would affect the generations to come. One single mishap occurred at Union Carbide Corporation. Bhopal left a detrimental impact on the surroundings. 500,000 people had to be evacuated from the village in Jaipur in 2009 when an oil tank carrying 8,000 kiloliters of oil caught fire. It took the officials more than a week to put the blaze out. Huge losses of life and property have been faced in such incidents worldwide. Explosives were randomly stored on the port of China, which blasted, and more than 700 people died in August 2015. The impact of Ukraine's Chernobyl power plant explosion in 1986 was felt by the Soviet Union and Europe, and the harm it caused is still being seen in 2005 in form of cancer and other diseases on the people. Next, ignoring occupational standards and safety standards. Many fatalities and injuries occur every year when the standard safety and occupational standards are ignored by the corporates. Death of employees due to accidents, mechanical errors, electric shock, causes damage of human life and leaves an impact on their families too. When the safety standards are ignored by the corporations, then existing conditions which otherwise may be harmless may cause potential harm to health, property, or environment. European Union, through its European Agency for Safety and Health at Work, in their report in 2009, reported that biohazards radiation result in substantial loss of life. Next, we have victims of unsafe product. This can be a defect in the product of the companies because of the design, manufacturing, or handling of the product while storage marketing. These defects have a direct effect on consumers have not foreseen an immediate danger while buying their products. England and Wales Office for National Statistics, London, in its report published in 2002, reported that approximately 2.9 million people get injured due to accidents at home. The accidents were related to handling of unsafe products due to design or manufacture. In 1978, the American automobile giant Ford had to claim back its Pinto cars as there was a defect in their fuel system. The explosions caused death of more than 180 people. Engineering and mechanical defects are more dangerous to handle. Product safety may be deliberately compromised by companies to save money and cut product cost. Then we have victims of industrial pollution. The Riru mine in Jharkhand has led to serious health issues faced by the AIDS community because of the 0.7 million tons of asbestos being dumped in the water. The land there is also getting affected because asbestos has covered the cultivated land as well. Even decades later, the water of Bhopal is still contaminated as benzene has seeped into the land, resulting in contaminated underground water. The immediate impact of the disaster may get over within few days, but long enduring imprints are visible for years to come. Nuclear disaster and other mishappenings have resulted in an outbreak of diseases like cancer, thyroid, malnutrition, and others all over the world. Then we have human rights violations. The guiding principle of business on business and human rights in 2011 has undertaken that the rule and duty to take care of human rights violation under the obligations of corporate legal liability, Rome Statute and corporate criminal responsibility. But ironically, the global world is witnessing a different scenario. Gross misconduct is done towards the laborers and employees in shape of forced labor, child labor, inhuman working conditions, denial of proper sanitation, no medical facilities, and others. In 2013, a South Korean company was told to pay $88,000 each to the victims whose human rights were violated by them during 1910 to 1945. The companies have multinational presence, and to this, they are feeling involved in offenses like human trafficking, physical abuse, torture, to get the maximum work out of the employees for profit. Let us move on to economic corporate crimes. Deceptive accounting. Corporations are worked within the regulatory framework. Corporations are required to prepare financial reports containing information about the financial health of the company. Such reports are retied by the investors, creditors, or other stakeholders. In the event when there is a falsification of audits to mislead or play deception, it may result in huge loss. Such incidents have happened in the case of Enron in the USA and Satyam in India. Enron was working in energy sector in the United States in the 2000s with revenues exceeding $100 billion. In India, the Satyam scandal in 2009 was the biggest corporate scam. Ramalinga Raju, the chairman of the Satyam, confessed that the company's accounts has been falsified. Raju inflated the company revenue, profit, and profit margin for every single quarter over 5 years from 2003 to 2008. It was a scam of 72,000 crores. Mr. Raju was declared guilty of two other accused. This led to the collapse of Satyam Group, a leading IT sector company. Then we have inside trading. Every day, a lot of significant and confidential information is exchanged between the officials of a corporation. But when this information is used to create profit for one's oversell by the employee, it is called insider trading. The misuse of the bonus price, the price cartelling, stock information can manipulate the balance of money in an outside's favor. The information can be passed by the employee or by the connected person like a banker, auditor, and others. Life savings of the individual can be lost within minutes because of insider trading. Then you have manipulation of the security market. The companies gain huge profits when they manipulate the market through security, maybe through this currency or by manipulating a commodity. These activities are created to generate the interest of an investor. But due to this, the state and individual can both face losses. The wrong and misleading information is posted, spread, or published related to stock to either increase or decrease the stock price of a share of the company. Huge ripple effects can be faced by the stock exchange within minutes of manipulation and can lead to crash of markets too. Then we have stealing trade secrets. Ayan. Every company has its strategy for working. This may be the business plans, the manufacturing details, business methods details, marketing strategies, future destinations, stock details. The company thrives on these trade secrets and it goes equally for the private or the public firms. Hacking into these trade secrets is a common threat and modus operandi for many corporations. Many methods are adopted by them to achieve this. A cyber attack may be initiated, or an insider employee may be bribed, or a setup may be instigated to manipulate the document. Theft of trade secrets not only affects the shareholders of the victim company, but also the community. It leads to intellectual property theft, corruption, illicit financial flow, occupational frauds, narcotics, trafficking, and black marketing. Then you have investment trends. Harshad Mehta, Ketan Parker, Ramalinga Raju are few names that the security market of India can never forget. They have been the reason for embezzling hundreds of prores through investment fraud in the last 30 years. Loopholes in the investment securities are misused to funnel out the money into their bank accounts. Fictitious and bogus firms are created, their bogus transactions are made, which only exists on paper, but their dividends and profits are procured in cash by these masterminds. In February 2014, Supreme Court of India ordered the arrest of Subrata Roy, the founder of Sahara Group, for failure to return over 20,000 crores plus interest, 15% to millions of its small investors. Jignesh Shah, founder of the MCX, was arrested for his alleged involvement in 5,600 Crore National Spot Exchange Limited scam. He failed to hand out 13,000 crores back to his investment. Investment scams lead to fraud, money laundering, bankrupting, and even loss of lives due to financial losses and rivalries. Then we have the corporate bribery. This is a type of crime where many times state also becomes a party. Huge monetary benefits exchange hands between private or public individuals to grab hold of a deal. Multinational corporations pay government to secure their business. The developing countries and the underdeveloped countries are the biggest playgrounds for the companies to play with the rules of corporate bribery. This operates a huge nexus between the government and the companies where bribery is concerned. Nixon's resignation in 1973 for the Watergate scandal brought the issue into the spotlight, and after that, many corporations and public individuals have been tried for this offense. The state revenue loss of opportunity, illicit flow of money, unemployment, it's just a few of the repercussions of corporate bribery, along with loss of trade and reputation. Then we have the corporate manslaughter, an offense where homicide of individuals result due to gross negligence on the part of the corporate. In these cases, the duty to take is misappropriated by the corporations. It's a crime under English law whereby the companies can be prosecuted for non-implementation of standards safely. Rules along with the precautionary steps required to be taken for employee safety. Big amusement parks, rail disasters, boat mishappenings, disaster in loss of lives at the activity grounds. There are a few examples where due to a mechanical glitch or an engineering fault, many times have been lost. Then we have the corporate liability for failure to prevent a negligent act. Negligent happens when the care and precaution to handle a particular situation is not taken care of. It becomes the liability and duty of the directors, managers, and all the others who occupy the position of importance to make sure that no inadvertent incident should happen because of slip of safety standards of manufacturing, processing, and use of a product. Breakage of security shaft detected breaks to stop a machine or uncovered electrical wires lying openly at the work premises are few examples of negligence which have resulted in loss of life. Countries like England and Hong Kong have laws to prosecute the directors or owners for acts of negligence. In India, we have an absolute liability of the company against the acts of negligence, environmental pollution, soil degradation are a few of the main acts that are undertaken by the companies deliberately. Offenses under the Companies Act. Within the guard of legal provisions, the companies are capable of committing many crimes. Tax evasion, obligating frauds, share rate fluctuation, dishonoring of checks, default bank accounts, Benami property transactions are visible in the functioning of the corporations. The Indian Companies Act of 2013 makes it the liability of the directors, the accountants, auditors to stop such frauds. These acts result in monetary loss, loss of reputation, and revenue for the company alone, with loss of faith from the investors. Acts like misstatement in the prosecutors, in the prospectus, liability to pay for qualification shares, a refund of share application money, fraud in contracts, fraudulent conduct of business, unlimited liability under the memorandum, income tax frauds, labor law violations, frauds on minority, state shareholders are such incident which can have the shareholders and the stockholders devastated. Okay, so this ends our discussion. For your activities, I gave you an AC type for activity one. If you listen and if you again read your modules, then you can completely answer the questionnaires in your activity one. Essay. Then you have activity two, which is multiple choice. Again, I advise you to make use of the elimination process for you to come up with the correct answer. So thank you and good day, everyone.